Cheryl's at the back.
Welcome to the subcommittee of the Health and Human Services Committee. We have one bill on our agenda today, House Bill 520. It's for a hearing only. We're not voting on this bill today.
Madam Chair, that might be a good spot to pause, and I'm happy to answer questions or proceed in any way you would like.
Well, I will kick this off with one question, and that is, did you guys happen to get a fiscal note on the House side?
I have been soliciting fiscal note. I did not formally ask for, I know that you have formally asked for a fiscal note, and I went over those data with Commissioner Nagel this morning, and they probably the same data she's giving you. And we have asked House Appropriations to prepare for us a sheet as our appropriations process goes forward. What are we funded on 520? What have we not funded yet? What's left on the table? We did that last year with 1013. Chair may remember we had a document that showed how each section, and we're preparing that document. I don't have it finalized for you today.
Questions from the committee?
Chairman Oliver, thank you for being here. Couple questions, and we can take some of these offline if we need to. I just wanted to understand some of the operative things that are important in this. One thing that comes up in Section 3 of the bill, the definition of serious mental illness. What exactly, that a lot hinges on that definition in this bill and as it sort of works outside and doing its work. What hinges on that definition? What kinds of decisions?
We're focusing on, the population that goes from jail to street to ER, from jail to street to ER. And this comes from Justice Boggs' work. The 143 jails don't have a definition for severe mental illness. And if you are going, as he is doing, Chief Justice Boggs, to look at grant funding and federal streams, you got to define what is a serious mental illness. And is it the same for the jail that's got, like, City of Decatur's jail at Closet versus DeKalb?
Well, really what I had in mind was what hinges on that? I mean, as you talk about, you know, involuntary civil committal and those kinds of things, there's certain elements you have to demonstrate to be able to say, yes, this threshold's been met, there's a certain set of conditions. Is a serious mental illness a necessary element of an involuntary committal?
Well, serious mental illness in the bill is different than is different from the legal standard by which a 1013 or a guardianship is created. And I'll address either one. They're not the same. Serious mental illness is essentially a medical diagnosis of a severe psychiatric illness. And there are definitions out there that say schizophrenia is less than 1% of our population is a serious mental illness, but there's no comprehensive definition.
Sure.
The capacity issue for a 1013 or a guardianship is different if you'd like me to discuss that, and it's not addressed in this bill.
So serious mental illness would maybe be a higher threshold than a committal, I think, right?
No, I wouldn't say that. I would say for me, it's really a medical diagnosis.
Would that be an element in a finding of incompetence to stand trial?
No, and the forensic aspects of this bill are very intentional because we have a set of statutes about someone being declared mentally ill and then being restored to capacity. In the issue of criminal setting, I think it deals mainly with the capacity to understand the criminal trial you're in. Do I know what I'm being charged with? Do I have the ability to participate in my own defense? That's significantly different than the capacity issue in a guardianship, and significantly different from the medical diagnosis of schizophrenia or other severe mental illness.
And Madam Chair, I raise the question because the delegation that happens here and the agency is going to be they're going to get about their business quickly. They're going to define this by December of 23. Important things are going to hinge on that definition, and it seems to me that is the province of the General Assembly to determine those kinds of if legally significant things are going to hinge on a definition. You know, we're in the business when we do our good work, and I know you've seen good work here, you've seen bad work here.
I've seen them.
When we do our good work, we write definitions that because so much hinges on. I'm concerned a delegation that's going to have this much impact legally, and there's other settings we don't have time to talk through. That's a concern.
I think you're raising an interesting issue that I have not thought about in terms of the definition of severe mental illness in your perception, perhaps. Serious mental illness, and perhaps impacting the issue of capacity to stand trial or the issue of granting of a guardianship for 1013. And I'm happy to take those questions back to the folks that work most in forensic and give you some more time and examples and understanding of that if it'd be helpful to you or the committee.
Yes, Representative, one of the things that has come up throughout the bill is referring to definitions that haven't been developed yet, and we're pretty protective in the General Assembly about defining things, and certainly happy to look at proposals from agencies for definitions, but I suspect that may be one thing we'll be working on, is being sure that we retain control of that process. We do have definitions of mental illness and substance abuse in the law, so this would be something different.
Thanks to everyone for coming down. Stay tuned. This is a long process. We're just the beginning of it. Thanks very much. We're adjourned.
I'm going to start